Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Dragon Orb by Mike Shelton. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. Chapter 1. Alison Stenos, wizard apprentice, walked with guarded steps down the main road leading into the City of Ore. Her shoulder-length black hair, bangs falling over one eye, framed her youthful, pale face. A small smile tugged at her lips as she surveyed the quiet street around her. Gorn Maron, her mentor, strode next to her. His hardened, battle-ready body belied his years. Only the graying hair indicated that his age was past what most people would call his prime. However, as a wizard, he could live close to 100 years. Battle wizards often lived shorter lives, however, due to their dangerous professions.
"Stay alert, Alli,"
Gorn whispered without turning his head.
"Always, mentor."
She skipped forward a step as she spun a foot-long knife in her right hand.
"They're here. I can sense them."
Gorn peered down a small alley to his right. The hot desert air stilled, and this usually bustling city, at the southernmost point of the kingdom of Alaris, sat too quiet for the middle of the day. Alli glimpsed a few women peering out of the corners of their windows, pulling their heads back when she glanced their way.
"Why don't these kingmen attack in a cooler place?"
Alli wiped the sweat from her forehead. Gorn glanced her way and motioned her over to the side of the street.
"I don't think these rebels care about the heat. They only care about disrupting the chief judge's government."
Alli nodded, her eyes darting from building to building. She and Gorn were leading a battalion of the chief judge's soldiers. They had heard about a group of rebels planning an attack on the governor's mansion in Orr. The king men called such for their desire to have a king rather than a system of judges ruling the kingdom, had become more bold lately. Gorn looked back and signaled for the rest of the battalion to proceed. Alli and Gorn turned the corner, walking toward the main city square. Two men jumped down from a window, swords in hand, and attacked the two wizards. Dozens of others appeared in the town square and, with yells, ran toward the wizards and their battalion of men. With her knife still in one hand, Alli used her other hand to pull her silver sword from the leather scabbard at her waist. She swung purposefully around her in a broad arc, widening the circle of attackers near her. The hot, orange sun sat directly behind her, sending out long shadows from the tan stone buildings bordering the town square. The two battle wizards pushed through the attackers, Gorn moving off to Alley's right. They used their physical weapons now, saving their magic for when they would need it the most. The determined men opposite Alli growled at being beaten back by a mere slip of a teenage girl. Embarrassment and frustration clouded their red faces, and they pushed forward with renewed determination. With no warning, a young boy ran out of one of the town's buildings, his mother chasing after him. Alli turned toward him, even though she knew she shouldn't fall prey to the distraction. Out of the corner of her eye, she noticed that fighting had erupted in the town square and was spreading down the side streets of Orr. If the boy didn't get back inside, he would not survive. The men used her distraction with the boy to press home their advantage. Alli grabbed one man's head and pushed him to the ground. Jumping up onto his back, she flipped over another attacker, reaching down to scoop up the boy with a well-toned arm. At the same time, she gathered her magical power and pushed it out from her hand with brutal force. The magic ran along the edge of her polished sword and out the end of the blade in a bright yellow flame. Holding the boy with her left arm, she held the sword's grip tightly with her right hand and turned in a circle. The flame shot out toward the remaining men in the area. 6 men fell instantly, 3 stumbled and tried to regroup, and 2 ran off, screaming, toward a trough of water, trying to put out their burning clothes. The terrified mother of the boy grabbed him back with a tearful thank you. Alli refocused on the fight. Turning, she saw Gorn a few yards away, shaking his head at her in bewilderment. She shrugged, and then plowed into a group of fighting men gathered in the far side of the square. Her battle moves were more a melodic dance than practiced motions. She flowed over the battlefield, barely touching the ground. Between the thrusts of her sword and the fire flaming from it, she took care of another 12 men. Eventually, she found herself back to back with her mentor, extinguishing the flames and returning to her knife and sword. She swatted away a new round of rebels.
Allison, why did you do that?
Gorn shouted over his shoulder as he fought off a few of the more brave renegades.
Do what?
Alli jumped up in the air and kicked a large bearded man to the ground.
Save that little boy. He almost got you killed.
But he didn't.
She turned to her right and parried the blade of a man twice her size. He mistook her size for inexperience, and she jumped into the air while spinning and came around, kicking him hard in the gut. She turned to face her mentor, the sounds of the man groaning on the ground fading from her ears.
We'll talk about this later,
Gorn said, wiping the blood from his sword onto a cloth hanging from his belt.
The boy was stupid for leaving the buildings.
Alli needed to concentrate, but she couldn't let this go.
Gorn, most of these people are innocent. They don't deserve to die.
Gorn only grunted. A large, dirty man tried to sneak up behind Alli, but Gorn brought his hand up and released a straight line of fire from his extended fingertips.
Thanks.
Alli smiled sweetly. Her youthful eyes and pale-skinned face stood out in innocent contrast to the bloody battle. She brushed her dark bangs out of her eyes and took a deep breath to calm her nerves. The heat of the desert city was affecting her more than had the exertion of the battle. Gorn grunted again, but this time with less care. Alli knew she infuriated him. Gorn had been in charge of her training since she had left the Citadel a year before, at age 14, and she loved him like a grandfather. No one could beat Alli in hand-to-hand combat, or with weapons of any kind. Her powers far exceeded her rank of apprentice, and many men underestimated her and mistook her youth, and her slight build, as weaknesses. This usually happened to be the last mistake they made. However, she really would like to be treated as a wizard rather than as an apprentice that many thought they could push around. Alli spied a young man moving on the other side of the courtyard, trying not to be seen. Before she could do anything, she felt the heat of magic shoot out from Gorn's fingers, racing toward the man. Throwing out her hands, Alli drew on the power of wind and pushed the wizard's flame back. Continuing on, the wind blew into a couple of old crates, knocking them down on top of the man, stopping him in his tracks, while protecting him from the heat of Gorn's magic flame.
You don't need to kill everyone, Gorn. There are other ways to take a man down.
But I am a battle wizard, and so will you be someday, Alli. You must learn that. In war, everyone is a potential threat.
So I shouldn't help you out then?
What?
Gorn's eyebrows shot up.
See you later,
Alli said and walked away from Gorn as a man tackled him from behind. She glanced back and grinned at Gorn, lying on the ground. She knew he could take care of himself. The captain of the battalion called out for assistance. Alli ran over to where another pocket of fighting had broken out, on the other side of the large town square. She pulled out two knives from the tops of her soft leather boots and threw them at the legs of two men who were about to take the captain down. They went down instead, holding their thighs and screaming in pain. The dry wind picked up. Her heightened sense of smell caught the odor of blood and sweat on its hot breeze. This heat washed over her for a moment until she pushed it from her thoughts. She thought instead of the forests farther north, near the magical barrier where she had grown up. She wished she was there and not on the edge of this forsaken desert. The people of Orr lived in the middle of a great desert in the far southern region of Alaris. The Mali River, running south along the western barrier, here flowed down through the canyons of the Great Divide toward the southwest, eventually joining the Dun River to the east. The only water around for miles, the Mali did little to alleviate the heat. Rumors held that the desert continued for miles south of the barrier, giving way ultimately to more fertile farmlands. But of course, the barrier of magic around Alaris blocked anyone from confirming the fact. The ground was hard-packed dirt. The buildings, a dull brown, all made from stone and clay, and the wind blew constantly. The only wood around was used for fires and pieces of furniture, and most likely came from the southern end of the elven forest to the east. Generations of desert living had made the skin of those in the southern region darker than that of the people farther north. Orr was normally a peaceful city, but then someone in town recently invited a group of kingmen to disrupt the peace and draw the chief judge's main battalion into battle. The dreary wasteland got on Alli's nerves, and she became tired of innocent people getting hurt and dying for no other fact than that they lived where the kingmen had decided to attack. During a brief respite from the fighting, she scanned the town square. Someone needed to end this fight. Looking at Gorn, she realized her mentor would disapprove, but she had been given her powers for a reason, and she would use them now to stop other innocents from dying. Holding her sword high and straight in the air, she chanted a few words softly. White fire erupted out of the tip. She spun the pommel of the blade vertically in the palm of her hand, and the white-hot light ran out of the sword in a dozen separate tendrils. "Protect the innocent," she whispered to the flames. The first man the flames hit fell in a startled heap on the ground. The next group tried to run, but the flames circled around their bodies, holding them tightly until they, too, collapsed to the ground and gave up their weapons. Even the soldiers in her own company backed away, afraid of standing in the way of the wild wizard's fire. The fire raced through the crowd and down the dirt lanes, sparing some and taking others, until the tendrils joined again and raced toward one lone man. His long legs carried him into the center of the town square. "I surrender!" The tall, unshaven man shouted as he threw his bloodied sword down and looked around wildly. Alli swept her hand back toward herself, and immediately the flame extinguished. The captain and a few others rushed forward to grab the man in the center of the town square, the leader of the attack.
"Where did you learn that?"
Gorn moved to her side. Alli shrugged her shoulders. "It just felt right."
"Felt right? You know the rules. You are only an apprentice," he said.
His thick gray eyebrows displayed his displeasure, and his forehead crinkled up in anger. "It's done, isn't it? No one else needed to die on our side. We gave them enough chances to stop." Alli glared up at Gorn in defiance. The fight needed to end.
I don't care,
his voice boomed, causing a few soldiers to turn toward the two wizards.
I am the master, and you are the apprentice.
Alli pushed her sword roughly into her scabbard and tried not to clench her fists. Her heart beat fast with anger. Why shouldn't she be allowed to use all her powers in a battle? She was a battle wizard, apprentice rank or not. This is only because I'm a young girl. I have trained for over 5 years at the Citadel and now at your side for the past year. Most men are only in training for 3 or 4 years, and I am more powerful than wizards at levels 1 and 2. Maybe even more powerful than you. You cannot control me forever, Gorn.
You are only 15, Allison.
Gorn shouted in exasperation. You are not old enough to be a full wizard.
That's simply the way it is.
My age should not define my rank. She stormed away, leaving Gorn standing alone. She approached the captain and the captured prisoner, pausing to listen to their conversation. Even while on his knees, the rebel leader was a tall man, his head almost coming up to Alli's chin. Blood dripped down his arms, wounds from the battle.
Why were you trying to take over the governor's palace?
The captain asked.
What did you do with the southern judge, Azim? You can't stop it from happening,
the man cried out.
We will have a king!
The captain spat on the ground, his spittle soaking into the dry dirt.
Not this again. The chief judge has been lenient so far with this king thing, but he can charge you with treason for what you did here today. That would be along with arson, civil unrest, and murder of some of my men now. Where are the southern judge and the governor? It was not my job to take them. That was for others. I don't know where he is. And what was your job? To disrupt things as much as possible. We need a strong king to hold Alaris together. The chief judge is weak. We want someone more powerful, someone who can break through the magic barrier holding us apart from the other kingdoms. We want a king like the other lands have.
His words sounded forced to Alli, memorized lines spewing forth from a small mind.
What do you know of other lands, renegade?
The captain spat. The barrier protects us from them, from the wars they would wage against us. Wise men put the barrier in place to save us from the other lands' evils and ambitions. We don't need a king. We have the judges. They have protected us for 150 years and will continue to do so. Do you deny the right of Chief Judge Damien Khoury to rule this land? All of the captain's remaining men gathered around them.
The chief judges stole the kingship away from the rightful rulers. We need to restore the nobility. You realize you now speak treason.
The captain motioned for some of his men to lift the prisoner to his feet. The captain took a step back so as not to appear diminished in size next to the sizable rebel. The captain turned to Alli.
Battle wizard apprentice. What should be his punishment?
The captain's attention surprised Alli. She wondered if Gorn had put him up to this, another one of his tests for her. Shifting her feet, she pulled the cloth band from her head, wet with the sweat of fighting. Then she leaned over slightly and shook her black hair out, loosening it from the nape of her neck. You want my advice? The captain nodded his head. She scanned the buildings and saw some of the townspeople edging out of their doors. At least a few of these families were fatherless after today, and this man in front of her was one of the leaders of the opposition. Do you have a family? Alli asked the rebel. A murmur of surprise rippled from the crowd.
What does that have to do with anything?
One of the men asked. The captain hushed him with a raised hand. Do you? She asked again.
No. Wife died in the desert.
All stood in silence, except for the constant rustling of wind around the stone buildings. Alli took two steps toward the rebel leader, putting her hands on her hips over her leather shirt.
"Then you shall join her today," she said.
Having delivered her verdict, she strode away. Her throat was parched. She needed some water. The captain called two men forward to take the rebel leader out behind one of the buildings for execution. Alli reached the crude water well. She sat down on its smooth stone edge and dipped in the bucket that hung from a rope for a drink. The water felt good going over her parched lips. Oh, to be back in the elven forest, or to travel along the Dun River. She tried to make these memories cool her down. Taking a deep breath, she closed her eyes momentarily. This blasted heat was infuriating. When she opened them again, a young boy stood in front of her, the same boy she had saved from the battle earlier. He was not more than 5 or 6. His dark hair, peppered with sand, hung in his eyes. Those brown eyes, sitting deep in his darkening face, begged for her attention.
"I want to be a battle wizard like you."
The young boy stood with his chest puffed up.
"Oh, you do, huh?"
Alli leaned forward.
"Why is that?"
"'Cause I want to kill the bad guys."
He stomped his foot to emphasize the point. "It's not all about killing." Alli peered behind the boy and saw Gorn approaching.
"It's not?"
"Oh, no. You have to practice a lot, eat healthy, and do what people tell you to do." With this, she glanced up at her mentor and gave him a smile.
"Oh."
The boy seemed to be thinking it over.
"I don't like it when people tell me what to do."
Alli and Gorn laughed.
"Neither do I."
Alli stood up and tussled the boy's hair. The boy's mother came up to him.
"I'm sorry. Again. I can't keep track of him, always scampering around."
"That's all right. He told me how he wants to be a battle wizard."
"Oh, he did?"
She looked down lovingly at her son. "Ever since you arrived yesterday, he hasn't been able to keep his eyes off you. Pardon me for saying, but aren't you too young to be a battle wizard?"
Allie's face reddened slightly. But before she might say anything in anger, Gorn stepped in.
"She may still be an apprentice, ma'am, but she is one of the most powerful battle wizards in all of Alaris."
Alli raised her eyebrows at him.
"Sometimes we forget that pure wizard power doesn't have anything to do with age. She stopped this battle today and did it without losing any more innocent people."
It was a rare day when Gorn praised her so.
"That's what I want to do, Mama. Help the
The young boy was having a hard time saying the word innocent.
"Good people,"
he said, his ears turning red.
"Well, then start doing your chores and eating healthy,"
Alli said to the boy. His mother led him away with a smile. Gorn turned to Alli.
"I'm sorry about what I said before. There has never been anyone like you. Well, there are a few others like you also, a new generation of apprentices that seem to exhibit extreme talent. We, the wizards at the Citadel, are not sure how to handle you."
"Wow, quite an admission coming from such a great wizard."
Alli flashed a large smile at him.
"Maybe there is hope for you yet."
"Now, despite the apology, what you did back there with the white flame..."
I know, it's dangerous and I shouldn't do things like that. But Gorn, it was the only way to end this infantile conflict. Fewer died this way than fighting until the last man falls. You might think I reacted without thinking, but I didn't. I thought about it, and it made sense. I thought it was the right thing to do.
The right thing to do is not always the best thing to do.
Gorn pulled a pail from the well and lifted a water skin from his side. His stomach rumbled, and he ran his hand over it.
Hungry?
Don't try to change the subject, but yes, I am. I don't see how you can do all that fighting and expend so much energy without getting hungry. You need to gain some weight. You are too thin to fight all day like this.
You are the one tiring. I'm doing fine.
Alli stood with hands on her hips. Gorn laughed and motioned for Alli to follow him.
Allison Stenos, you might very well be one of the most dangerous people I know.
One minute you are comfortably ordering a man's execution, the next you are sitting with a young boy and giving him advice.
You wield mercy as quickly as you dispense justice. You are going to be extremely difficult for a future husband to figure out.
Alli grew serious and stopped. She put her small hand on Gorn's arm and stopped him.
Gorn, don't ever think my swift justice is comfortable. Don't think I like killing or deciding to take the life of a war criminal. Don't make me into a monster for dispensing justice.
Gorn took a step back, and fear flashed in his eyes for a brief moment.
Alli, I didn't mean it that way. I just meant that you are complicated to understand. I'm sorry if I offended you.
Alli relaxed. Two apologies in one day? I'm beginning to think you are getting soft in your old age.
Ouch!
Now let's go find you a good meal.
She pushed him forward and headed toward their camp on the edge of town.
Now that's something I can understand.
You'd better hurry and take your fill. It's a long road back to Cassian. The chief judge will want a report as soon as possible.
Chapter 2. In the middle of a small practice yard inside the chief judge's castle, in the capital city of Cassian, Roland Tyre danced around his opponent and flashed quick smiles to the sidelines, all to the delight of his many female onlookers. Their squeals and cheers motivated the 16-year-old more than did his instructors. Brushing his blonde hair out of his eyes, Roland parried the sword of his opponent, one of the more seasoned guards in the castle, and beat him back a few feet. He gazed up at the crowd with his dark, blue, penetrating eyes, and noticed one of the more lovely girls wiggling her fingers at him in a friendly wave. He pursed his lips at her in a mock kiss, sending ripples of giggles through that clique of teenage girls. It was a warm summer day, and Roland was getting hot and thirsty. Sweat beaded on his forehead and dripped down the sides of his handsome face and square chin. Then, his opponent swept toward him with a fierce blow. Roland jumped up into the air, higher than a normal man should be able to, and followed this with a quick wave of his hand. The guard opened his eyes wide in astonishment as his sword seemed to leave his hand of its own volition, flying upward, and then crashed to the dirt.
"That's not fair!"
The guard reached down to grab his sword. But Roland put his foot down on the blade.
War is not fair.
What do you grasp of war or battles?
The seasoned guard sneered.
You are going to be a counselor wizard.
Roland's jaw clenched. The guard had hit a sore spot.
I know that if I need to fight, I will use everything at my disposal to win.
There is no honor in what you did, apprentice.
Onius Neeland, a thin, older man with long, graying hair, approached the pair.
Yes, in a real battle you may need to use all of your resources. But in practice, with someone who is helping you learn, you should restrain yourself.
I don't need lectures, Onius.
Roland snapped as he removed his foot from the guard's sword. And I don't need any more practice today. I was hot and wanted a drink, so I ended the fight.
You should apologize.
Roland cringed inside. Onius Neeland could be so infuriating with his sense of honor and patience. Roland stared into the older man's blue eyes. Being a wizard slowed his aging so that, even though he was close to 80, Onius looked like he was in his 50s. Onius, a third-level counselor wizard, had been guiding judges for a generation before Roland was even born. Continuing to put on a show for his spectators, Roland bowed deeply to the guard and, in his most gracious voice, said, "My dear good man, I apologize for any slight I have given thee. My intentions were not to offend. I'm afraid that, with the hot weather and the looks of the beautiful damsels upon me, my thinking became irrational this day." He bent down with a flourish, picked up the dirtied sword, and handed it reverently to the guard.
"No offense taken, sir,"
the guard said with a forced smile. He knew to tread lightly around the young wizard apprentice. Roland turned and bowed again to the ladies, making sure he gave a special wink to the one who had waved at him so nicely earlier. Hopefully, he could meet her later that evening in a corner of the town square for a few kisses. Then Onius pulled Roland off the field, moving toward the kitchen.
"Well done,"
he said in a mocking voice. "Oh, Onius, don't be so stiff. You're letting your age get the better of you. I was only having fun out there."
"Your magic is not something to have fun with, Roland.
All wizards have a responsibility that needs to be taken seriously." "Now you sound like our stuffy chief judge." Roland rolled his blue eyes upward toward the castle. "All about duty and responsibility."
"Chief Judge Damien Curry is a good man.
Better than most of us." Onius stopped and glared down at Roland. His tall, thin frame still stood a few inches above the growing youth's, but Roland had grown tall in the last year. "I know he is good and honorable and responsible, but maybe, if he tolerated more fun, the people would relate to him more and not be wanting a king instead." Onius seemed to grow serious and surveyed the area before saying, in a lowered voice,
"You mustn't talk about that in the open, Roland. You should appreciate, as much as anyone, what a touchy subject that is right now. Things will work out for the best."
Roland considered Onius with suspicion. "You know how it's going to work out, do you, Onius? I haven't run across that power yet." Onius opened his eyes wide at this implication, his gray eyebrows rising on his wrinkled forehead.
"I don't know what you mean, Roland. Now, move it. You will need to learn to be more responsible in your training before you can figure out the doings of the government of Alaris."
Roland pouted. "I was only having fun out there," he said under his breath.
"Roland!"
roared Onius. Shaking his head to get the sweaty hair off his neck and out of his face, Roland felt a flash of anger. "I would take some responsibility if you gave me something interesting to do, Onius. Sitting around and reading about history, judges, and negotiations is tedious." He barely controlled the urge to stomp his foot. "You and the council at the Citadel know I'm more powerful than any other apprentice. Besides skill I have learned as a counselor, I also have strengths as a battle and scholar wizard. Raise me from an apprentice and treat me as a full wizard, and I might show some responsibility." A servant came out of the kitchen then, saw the two wizards arguing, and with a small yelp, turned and ran back inside. The arguments of Roland and his mentor were notorious in the castle. Roland toppled forward as a swat of air smacked his backside. "Ouch! Why did you do that?"
Because you are acting like a spoiled child, Roland.
Onius shook his bony finger at him.
Do you know why the Wizard Council hasn't raised you to a full wizard yet? It is exactly because of what you just said. You think you possess all of this power, and you think you deserve those titles and responsibilities, and that everyone loves you and swoons over you. When you can get your head on straight, use your powers responsibly, show some humility, and accomplish something of note, you might earn the right to move from apprentice to a level one wizard. Great things could be in store for you, Roland. You do have potential, but you need to figure out what you want soon. Changes are coming.
What do you mean, changes? Roland asked.
Onius closed his mouth tight, as if he feared saying too much.
Things are happening in the kingdom, Roland, if you haven't noticed, and you might not have much time to straighten yourself out.
Roland hung his head low for a moment, feeling actually surprised at this outburst from the usually even-tempered wizard. Something was bothering his mentor of late. He was more uptight than normal. What Onius had said about taking responsibility made sense. But Roland couldn't change who he was. The power was so strong in himself he didn't know how to handle it sometimes. It was a part of him, like his arms or legs or ears. None of the other wizards understood. Maybe, though, just maybe, he did need to find something good to accomplish. He made a mental note to find something to work on that would show Onius he was ready to be a full wizard. Onius stood, glaring down at him, clearly waiting for a response. Roland lifted his head in a slow and deliberate motion, his eyes growing big, the corners of his mouth turned upward, and he began to laugh.
"And what is so funny now, my spoiled apprentice?"
Onius forced a smile.
"You used your magic to spank me. I've never seen you lose your temper so. It's actually quite funny."
Onius joined Roland in barking out a laugh at the situation. After a moment, the young apprentice wizard glanced around and, much to his dismay, saw that his gaggle of girls was gone. He frowned for a second, until he thought of one of the cook's helpers, a finely shaped, dark-haired girl, only slightly younger than himself. He smiled again. Saying a farewell to Onius, Roland walked through one of the back doors of the castle and into the hot kitchen. Responsibility could wait until the next day. He grabbed some freshly baked bread off of the large wooden counter in the middle of the warm kitchen. Fetching a tall cup of ale for himself to go with the bread, he was disappointed to learn that only the cook, a large woman older than his mother, tended the ovens that afternoon. So, he headed off to his room to change and relax before heading out to the city to find the girl from the practice yard. She had such a nice smile. Passing by the chief judge's chambers on his way to his own made Roland rethink the conversation with Onius, so he decided that before going to town, he would go to the library and ask back about the history of wizards and where he actually fit in. Inside the chief judge's chambers sat Damian Khoury himself. Always amazed at the amount of paperwork needing to be done to oversee the other judges and the people of Alaris, he shook his head to clear it for a few more minutes. There were four other judges spread throughout the land. The people democratically voted for all five judges, with the chief judge being voted on by the other judges. They kept the laws of Alaris, along with support from the captains of the armies and the constables of the smaller cities, but there never seemed to be an end to the petty squabbling. Sometimes he wondered if he had made a difference. He had been in Cassian now for 7 years, 3 of those as chief judge.
"Sir, do you need anything else tonight?"
His head steward had stepped into the room without Damien noticing.
"No. I will be retiring soon. Please leave a message for my wife. I will be done within the hour."
The steward left, and Damien rose from the padded chair. He stretched his tall, tired back and ran his hands down his long, thin sideburns, ending at his short, brown beard. The white speckles in his once black hair stood out in contrast with his light brown skin. His back hurt more now than when he was younger. Being a large man, he didn't like to be crouched down in the small office chairs for hours on end, but that seemed to be happening more in recent days. He walked over to a window. It was still light outside, though the sun had just set behind the farms and fields to the west. A few lamps in nearby homes began to show as the summer twilight settled in. The pink sky reflected off the Corwan River to the east, forming a colorful ribbon, running from the Dun River in the northeast, then back southwest to join it again near Corwan. The Corwan River supplied all the water for the city's needs. The city of Cassian was as old as they had histories for, but it had only been the capital of Alaris for the past 150 years, ever since the barrier had gone up around Alaris and the new government system of judges had been enacted. When the old king and government had been replaced by the system of judges, the capital was moved from Waylon, near the wizard's citadel, to Cassian, a beautiful and peaceful city in the middle of Alaris. Damien had worked hard to minimize the poor and beggars, and, though crime would never be totally eradicated, he felt proud of all his accomplishments during his time as a lower judge in Orr and now as chief judge of the land. He watched the people walking home in the warm summer air as vendors closed up their neatly organized shops for the day. Then, Damien felt a strange breeze blow by him and thought he heard a noise in the room. He turned and ran his eyes over the room. It all seemed in order. He took in the large tapestry on the wall next to the door, the stone fireplace he had not used since late spring, the shelves of books outlining the history of the law of Alaris, and then his desk. The feeling that something in the room had changed lingered in the back of his exhausted mind. So Damien closed the window and leaned back over his desk to straighten his papers. Then a letter caught his eye. He hadn't noticed it before. He opened it with a quick tear and cringed. Wizard Kanzar Centauri had invited, no, that was too nice a word for it, commanded Damien to the Citadel for a meeting. Damien threw down the letter in disgust. He needed to talk to Onius first thing in the morning. Onius understood Kanzar more than anyone. Damien knew that others plotted behind his back because some of the people wanted a king, and he would bet Kanzar was involved. The man plainly loved power. As chief judge, Damien needed to visit one more place this evening before retiring to his living quarters. He needed to see Bakari in the library. There were rumors of the magical barrier weakening in places, especially along its eastern edge, the boundary they shared with Elven. The wizards, including Onius, had remained closed-lipped about it. If anyone knew the information, it would be Bakari. In the past year, Damien had learned many times to rely on the young scholar wizard's memory and wealth of knowledge. Damien reached over to pick up the cup sitting on the edge of the table. As he brought it to his lips, he paused for a moment and frowned. The cup, still chilled, dripped with condensation. He didn't remember having asked for anything to drink recently. He reasoned that it must be from the steward, anticipating his needs and bringing it in before leaving for the evening. He took a swallow from the silver cup and brought it with him as he headed down the darkening corridors of his castle. This thought startled him. He had never thought of it as his castle before. That was dangerous. He knew he served here for only a 5-year term, and he was only a servant of the people, a judge. There was a big difference between that and a king. From what he understood of history, kings only brought problems. Kings brought wars, and the last king of Alaris, before the barrier went up, was a powerful wizard. The main purpose of creating the barrier was to protect Alaris from greedy kings in nearby kingdoms. Two guards fell in behind him as he walked to the library. Their footsteps were quiet on the long run of blue woven carpet, running down the middle of the halls in this part of the castle. As he rounded the last corner, Damien bumped into someone, and a portion of his drink splashed out, dampening the carpet. The other man stumbled, but put a hand to the wall to keep from falling down. "Watch where you're going," the other man said before looking up. The guards tensed and moved to intervene.
"Roland?"
Damien reached a helpful hand over to his apprentice counselor. Roland's face turned red and he apologized. The guards relaxed. They recognized Roland and nodded their heads to him.
"What are you doing in this wing?"
Damien asked. "Oh, just hanging around waiting to be knocked over," Roland said with a wink, trying to use laughter to diffuse the awkwardness of the situation. Damien didn't laugh. Roland needed to be more serious about his duties if he planned to be a counselor to one of the judges in the land. Taking a long drink from his cup, Damien motioned for Roland to follow him to the library. "That's where I was going," Roland mumbled. As Damien reached for the handle of the door, a wave of dizziness washed over him, and he swooned to the side. One of the guards reached over and tried to steady him. He began to choke and felt his eyes starting to roll back in his head. Then his fingers relaxed around the cup and it fell to the floor, bouncing twice, spilling its remaining cool liquid on the carpet in front of the library's door.
Chapter 3.
"Back!"
Roland yelled, pushing the door of the library open with a bang. The young, dark-skinned youth with short, dark hair and homemade glasses came running to the door. He seemed out of breath and almost tripped on his long scholar's robes.
"Roland!"
"The chief judge has collapsed." Bakari stood for a moment, staring at the fallen judge, then took off his glasses and pinched his nose.
"Back! Stop standing there and help us!"
Roland shouted.
"Pull your head out of your books. We need a place to lay him down."
Of course, on the couch here."
He motioned them to a well-built brown couch in the sitting area of the castle library. Books lined a multitude of shelves around them. Since Bakari was already a level 1 wizard, protocol dictated he take the lead, even though Roland was more powerful. So Roland watched as Bakari ran his hand over the chief judge's body.
"He's been poisoned."
"Brilliant deduction," was what Roland wanted to say. He could tell that. Sometimes Bakari's head was so far into his books it took him a while to return to the real world.
"The cup was in his hand."
One of the guards started to fetch the cup from the doorway, but Roland flipped his hand out and brought the cup through the air to them. Bakari sniffed it and closed his eyes.
"Well?"
Roland urged.
"What is it?"
Bakari didn't acknowledge Roland except to hold up his finger to tell Roland to wait a moment. Roland sat, impatiently, looking across at the young scholar wizard. Bakari had grown up at the Citadel as an orphan and, during that time, had won the respect and favor of most of the other wizards for his ability to recall anything he had seen or read. And his being named a full wizard a year earlier, at 14 years old, got on Roland's nerves. Roland ground his teeth together. While Roland did everything quickly and impetuously, Back moved slowly, thought slowly, and took his time doing everything. Malok, Bakari said. Roland was once again amazed at what Bakari could remember from the many books he had read. Maybe there was still hope for the kid after all.
Should we find the physician?
One of the burly guards asked. The man clearly didn't want to be held responsible for the chief judge dying on his watch. He would end up, at best, working along the magical barrier. The antidote can only be made through the use of a magic spell. Bakari said, "We must get Onius. The chief judge doesn't have much time." Bakari stood up to go find the older wizard. "Back, no, wait!" Roland closed his eyes. "I will." To the obvious surprise of everyone in the room, Roland remained there and kept his eyes closed. He pictured Onius in his mind, concentrated hard, and then spoke to his mentor's mind. "Onius, come to the library now. The chief judge has been poisoned." He felt a response, as if Onius had actually jumped up in surprise, so he reiterated the point, "Hurry!" Then, Roland opened his eyes and saw Bakari holding his head in his hands.
"What did you do? My head is killing me."
"I called Onius with my mind," Roland said matter-of-factly.
"Well, your power washed over me on its way there. You need to learn to focus better."
Roland grunted and furrowed his eyebrows at the young wizard standing opposite him. Bakari smiled. "Sorry, Roland. I didn't mean it wasn't amazing. It's just that you killed my head. I don't know of anyone else with that ability, except for a few level 4 or 5 wizards. How did you do that?"
"Yes. How?"
boomed a loud voice as Onius rushed into the room, his robes swirling around him.
"A great scholarly question, but one that can be answered later. Now, what happened?"
Bakari showed Onius the empty cup, in which the residue of the poison, mixed with a chilled juice, still lingered.
"Water. We need water,"
Onius informed them.
"We need to dilute the poison before it gets farther in his system."
Roland glanced down and frowned. "I can't move water yet," he mumbled. "At least not without making a mess," he thought to himself. So he jumped up and ran down the hall to a small common room that was on the same floor. He returned in moments with a full mug. Onius put his large, bony hands under the chief judge's head and brought it up a foot from the cushions of the couch. He lifted water to the chief judge's lips and watched as his reflexes swallowed automatically. Then the old wizard leaned down and listened to Damien's heartbeat.
"Slow and fading,"
Onius said. By this time, others had heard the commotion and begun to gather around. Damien's wife, Mara, came in and collapsed on the ground in tears. Bakari tried to comfort her, but didn't succeed much.
"Papa?"
The sound of Damien's 10-year-old son reached their ears from the hallway.
"What happened to Papa?"
"I need quiet here to work,"
Onius grumbled. He motioned for the guards to take the child away.
"Roland, get me an oak leaf."
"What?"
"This is no time for your questions."
Onius's expression was grave.
"Go! A few oak leaves and more water."
Roland motioned a guard to come with him. After telling the man to fetch the water, Roland ran down 3 flights of stairs to gather the oak leaves. A group of girls squealed and jumped out of his way, almost falling down the stairs. "Sorry," he said, giving his attention to one in particular. Her soft blonde curls hung down in ringlets to her shoulders. He hadn't noticed her in the castle before. He refocused himself as he took the last 3 stairs with one jump. He needed to do what Onias had asked him and show his level of responsibility to his mentor. The leader of Alaris was on the brink of death, and it all rested on Roland getting the leaves for the antidote. The chief judge seemed like a boring man to Roland, but he would never have wished him to die. Slamming the ornate castle doors open, to the chagrin of the 2 guards, Roland ran out to the lawn in front of the great 4-story castle. He raced past more guards at the bottom of some steps and ran to the big oak tree out front. He paused and caught his breath. The castle grounds were filled with waves of colorful flowers. To Roland's left, dahlias larger than his hand bloomed in gardens surrounded by freshly cut grass. To his right, lavender asters stood over bright purple petunias. The leaves of the oak tree stood on enormous branches high above his reach. So, without thinking it through, Roland gathered his power and pushed out his hand to bring a few leaves down. In his urgency, Roland caused the entire tree to lose all its leaves within a matter of seconds. He cringed inside at his lack of control, but he jumped to catch 2 large leaves floating down through the air above him and then ran back toward the castle. The guard's eyes were wide as Roland ran back inside. He paused only a moment to glance back outside, and then wished he hadn't. Oak leaves drifted to the ground, soon to cover the entire garden area around the central portion of the lawns. Roland groaned out loud and took the stairs up 2 at a time. He shoved the leaves into Onias's hand, along with the water the guard had already fetched for him.
"The Mal Oak is a rare oak, whose leaves, when mixed with healing magic, can slow down the heart rate until, eventually, the person will die."
Onias crushed the oak leaves into the mug.
"This oak, being a relative of the Mal Oak, along with a spell, should help to combat the poison."
"I hope he survives," Bakari said softly.
Damien's wife moaned, and one of the guards picked her up off the floor and helped her to a nearby chair. Roland watched Onias carefully. If he was to be a counselor to the judges, he would need to protect them as well. Onias settled his right hand over the top of the mug and chanted some words. Roland felt the effects of the words in the air, but the spell seemed incomplete to him. He didn't know why. Onias began to lift the mug to the chief judge's lips.
"Wait!"
Roland said with so much authority that Onias stopped. His gray, bushy eyebrows rose in question to Roland's outburst. Roland put his right hand over Onias's and pulled both hands back over the cup.
"Say it again." "Roland, we don't have time for you to learn this right now. Just do it!"
Roland said with such force that Onias complied, and Bakari took a step back at the command. When both of their hands hovered over the cup, Onias chanted his spell once again, and then Roland added 2 words to the end.
"Keolam novis."
He didn't know why, but he knew it was the right thing to do. The power flowed through him immediately and into the cup. This was one more reason to talk to Bakari about his magic. Onias had jumped when Roland spoke those last words.
"Keolam novis?"
Onius asked. He frowned and then added softly,
Malok, backwards, and the spell word for reverse.
He brought the mug to Damien's lips and forced a cupful into him. Everyone waited in silence. How did
you? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.